Now I want to show a little bit of the earth that is, if it is absolutely ruined, how it looks. Now here you can see, this is the neighboring, just outside our forest farm. There's no carbonaceous content in this water, it's stone hard. See, if it rains, the rain will not percolate, it will just flow off. And then there's nothing, there's no, it's like a tight cement almost. And so, once the topsoil is gone, it becomes like this. The roots can't penetrate this type of earth. If you put seedlings or throw seeds, nothing will sprout here. It's as good as dead. But still, the ants are doing a heroic activity of trying to retrieve it, see. If you don't get a plow and dig up this place, in due course they'll drill holes all over the place and then tunnels will form. That makes it easy for the roots to penetrate. And then, in the soil erodes, these stones start poking out. There used to be mud all around here. Now the soil has washed out. Stones start jutting out. And if you do forest farming here, all these stones will slowly get covered by the mulch and they'll disappear underground. Earth will become dark brown and you'll have seeds and all sprouting everywhere. So that's the importance of the topsoil and conservation of the topsoil. Now we'll look at a sacred tree. These sacred trees are a feature of many societies. And this is an example. This is a Ficus religiosa, and next to it there's a neem tree, and the ficus is very ancient. It must be about 200 years old, and but sadly, even here, the march of progress is happening. The base of the tree has been shrunk by adding cement pavement. There was much bigger surrounding for mud for this. And one big tree has been cut off to make space for the road. So, a huge, in fact, about 200 year old neem tree was cut off here to make way for this little road for cement. But this tree was too sacred, they just couldn't get the guts to cut it off. So, they spared it, they reduced the amount of rooting space available for it to breathe. So now this tree will be a little bit choked for breath. Anyway, it's not been cut, that's a relieving feature. And all the pagan, so-called pagan type of societies have retained tree worship. And India has this tree worship in a strong way, so therefore next to the national highway, these two trees have been spared because they are holy. So holiness confers longevity to a tree. Immunity from woodcutters. This is another example of the second method of cultivating ginger, which is like a semi-wild way. Now, this can only be done if the earth has completely recovered from all that damage. And I'll show you a little bit about the earth here. The quality of weeds indicate the health of the soil. Now these juicy succulent weeds start coming when there's enough juice in the earth. And then there's no stones visible here, see. You can't see any rock because they're all submerged by the mulch and other things. So it's completely soft, thick, mulched earth like a forest floor. And here this naturalized ginger can be cultivated. Now, these have, after the rain, these have sprouted on their own. This is also the third year of this ginger. I planted a 1-inch piece here in the middle under the grapevines. And it's been growing every year. It's now spread up till here. And for this, I don't take much care. We add vermicompost little bit periodically and then just let it be. And according to the natural cycles, it's sprouting, flowering and dying back, and again the cycle is repeated. I'm planning to leave it for a few years. Just let it survive and exist. And it'll spread on its own, and in a healthy soil,
See, compare this soil with earlier what I showed, the degraded soil. The same, that kind of degraded, desertified soil can support this type of vegetation and lushness if the earth is healed back. Now, all this greenery has sprouted on its own. This, all this portulaca, it's come by itself. And as you can see, it's fully green carpet has come just with two rains. Not a drop of water has washed away, everything percolated and supported the nice lush life. Now, I have selected a waste area which is quite shady. There's shade of two supporter trees and one huge Pterocarpus marsupium. There's a lemon shrub and there's Alpinia galanga also all around. So, in this waste area, shady area, nothing else actually grows. Make a hole in the ground. Huh? Show the hole. Make a hole like this. Put it in. And then close it up. And then we'll pour one bucket of water as a treat, starting capital for the thing. And then select the surrounding leaves and keep it up like this. So one more is planted. Now the next one here. This is the maximum digging what we do here, nothing more than this. The earth also is very soft. A single strike and it's done. It is not stone hard or some crazy situation like that. It's a soft and nice porous earth. So by next year these will become about 2 to 3 kgs of each. And in between, we'll hardly attend them. Maybe one feeding of vermicompost in between. Now all three are gone. Let's cover all three. See, first one. And the second one and the third one. So behind this, Alpinia galanga. Suck off.
Yes, I started.
We're going to look at the jungly method of cultivated ginger today once again, and now you can see some progress. Let's sit down. Now this is the second year growth for this one, and compared to the cultivated version, the clumps are closer, all the stems are kind of gathered up together in a much dense formation. And at this stage, it growth depends entirely on how you feed it. So see, I dumped some vermicompost here. So you can heap it up. If it's a low rainfall area, then you can dump it up like this. If it's heavy rainfall, the whole thing has to be planted in raised areas, because it will rot if there's too much continuous rain. Now this farm, being in near Bangalore and having moderate rainfall, we can almost plant anywhere. And I not raised the bed, nor it's a hollow area, just general kind of level land. And next to it there's a turmeric. This is turmeric. So turmeric leaves are much bigger, and it is much higher compared to, it grows in the same conditions like ginger, but this is much hardier plant. Turmeric can survive with even less care and even more harsher conditions than ginger. And now go ahead, I will look at the star ginger clump. This ginger I already showed in the earlier video. So it has grown now almost, just show the height. See, it next to me. See, it's come up to my chest almost. That means 5'10". And then just touching it releases a beautiful ginger smell into the air. So I am now surrounded by ginger aroma. This clump is three and a half years old. It's a beautiful, nice clump it has come out. I'm very proud of. I think it's a her. It's a girl. I'm very proud of her and what height and color and everything. And I'm going to let her be probably forever, hopefully. Now, I also want to show the ash gourd. This is the ash gourd number 3 from this creeper. First one was about 10 kilos. Second one was 14 kilos. This is not yet harvest. We are going to leave it here for a while. And I have taken this up as the main gourd of the season. And going to raise a lot of plants this year. So this is one of them. It will probably be 10 kgs. See the weight. And then there's Dioscorea also growing side by side. Multi-cropping as usual. And then Helica carbum, Cardiospermum. So we are continuing the show. It was interrupted by telephone call, sorry. Now, so I'll repeat. There's a grape plant. And then there's red color Basal Alba here. This one. And then there's ash gourd. This one, and the plant is continuing to grow because I'm continuing to feed it. And then there's Dioscorea. Now where Dioscoreas have spread quite energetically all over the place. And underneath is the ginger. Ginger, turmeric. I want to show two more species here. This is that portulaca which we call Nelabasle. We all like it very much as a summer vegetable. And there are two types of weeds here which are edible. This one, I forgot its name. And then underneath, there is the shatti, Camphaera galangal. There's one plant here, and then there's one more there. So, no weeding, too much sun, and too much shade, I mean, and then no watering, all kind of funny conditions. It's thrived very well. So, once you plant it, you can forget about this sati. Only thing is, no one should step on it. It grows well with ginger. Ginger grows well along with turmeric. So all three can be taken up in this jungly way of cultivation. And one more plant, two more plants to show. This is arrowroot. This is a very important nutritious kind of a tuber. And I spread it all over the forest, farm, garden, earth now, wherever soil is fully healed. It's growing very well and beautiful, those tubers. And see the earth here. It's rich, dark brown. And then here, everything can, any crop will grow beautifully and healthy. No question of sickness here. And one more plant is there, the wild ginger. All are crowded up here, but they're quite happy. This is a wild ginger. It's a little bigger version of the domestic variety. And the smell is less spicy. Leaf shape is the same. And then the flowers are also the same, but bigger. These flowers, when they open again, I'll make a separate video. And then we have more gingers here. Ginger, all the ginger has been fed with vermicompost. So that's the progress on the gingers. This is a second look at the cultivated way of growing ginger. Here, there's a hollow has been made to water the plant and all that. And then we go on adding a fresh food on the raised area, raised bed. And what we are doing, we added a lot of dead leaves. And then some, this earth from here has been scooped up and dumped there on top. And the height is quite nice and it's come out quite healthy. There's no disease as such anywhere. And then the neighboring bed looks even better. We have increased the ginger this year because it's in great shortage and organic ginger is very hard to get. And there's great demand also. People want good quality ginger, fussy people. Now here we have added red earth, and then underneath there's the chicken, the waste from the chicken coop. First, underneath the floor of chicken coop, add our dead leaves. Once in 15 days, scoop it up and spread it over here. That rich food, make sure that the ginger, those rhizomes are fat and nice. Now, this side, also the growth is quite healthy and they are quite tall actually. They are now, say 5 feet almost, 4.5 feet tall. And it is a successful crop actually. At this stage, I shouldn't say anything because heavy rains can ruin it. Unseasonal rain, 24 or 48 hour rains, then rotting will start. Otherwise, it looks nice to my eyes. And so that's about the. There's one more. Elephant foot yam here. This one is crossed my height, that means 6 foot, above 6 foot now. 6 foot 2, I think, almost. And looking very nice, kind of. Okay, so let me after that. One more elephant foot yam. So these are scattered all over the place. Where underneath this is underneath the supporter tree, the third elephant foot yam and the fourth one. So these are all additional sources of food. That can, you can use up the waste. Normally in the orchard, this place nothing will be planted. So weeds will be coming. Here we've got all these vegetables growing. It doesn't disturb the supporter tree also. So with all these little tricks, we improve the performance of the farm. Having one more look at the ginger patch today. Now these are chilies. Chili flowers have come, and some moth is there. Not moth, butterfly I think it is. And then the gingers have grown quite nicely. There is one more type of chili. Yeah, bad ginger. This is called badgi. It's a thin and skinny and long variety, and very much preferred for certain type of dishes.
And not spicy.
Not very spicy. Now this chili plant is having a caterpillar and other things. Creatures are there, but nevertheless it's healthy. All right. Now we'll walk through like that. Now here we have utilized the space between the supporter trees to make small patches of ginger, and ginger is now about 5 feet tall. All that chicken manure and vermicompost has done had a good effect. And in between the ginger, we also grown some neeli. That is that
indigo
ferra tinctoria. It's a blue indigo, which is used in the neeli bringa the oil. So ginger and neeli, chilies in between the supporter trees. Okay. This is how the ginger looks in the middle of the season. Now they'll start flowering next. Say in a month's time when the flowers come, I'll do the next video of this.
This is a great falls in the Western Ghats, middle of the Western Ghats actually. This is called Ramana Kanive area, and also this is known as Taravati Wildlife Sanctuary. And I'm in the middle of the forest with a beautiful natural waterfall. The water is gushing in such speed that I'm actually really scared to even shoot the whole thing.
This is a bigger variety of azolla which the hens like. This one, and then this is a smaller variety, which is good for the chicks. They all eat this. This is too big for the chicks. The hens are able to swallow it up. This is the ideal size for the chicks. These are all 7 months old now. They started laying a few eggs also. This is our new coop, extended coop, almost quarter acre, sufficient space for them to run around. There is our, this fellow sings the blues. He's called Punjab Boiler, also Bob, and he sings beautifully.
Now we are going to plant the air potato, which is just plucked by mistake. Now here I want to show, this is, I have selected an area of the forest farm where we don't do any watering, or this is a jungly part almost, and but they are full of useful trees but not much cultivation as such. We got here, this is the Sitapal or custard apple there, and then this is the Shankhu Pushpi, Clitoria ternata creeper, and then here we got that wild ginger. This is one of the some kind of a fungus, I think it grows on bamboo. This one, and then here's the, this is the forest ginger, that is a wild relative of our officinalis, the cultivated ginger's wild cousin. It looks like this. Let's go closer and take a look. Now this is a flower there, After the flowers fall off, slowly this green thing becomes red, fully red cones. And this amazing thing about these cones, they usually hold water. See this one now, it's got water, and actually this water is quite nice to drink. Want to see the taste? Gingerish type of. So, see? So if you're lost in an evergreen forest and you're thirsty, maybe a little of this you can drink and save your life. See? Quite a bit of juice, huh? Amazing. So, that's the old flower. Now, let's plant the air potato.
Lovely.
A little slimy, no? Okay, now show the ground. Now, here you'll see, this is a proper forest floor conditions I have recreated here. It's a thick, dark brown mulch is there, and earth color is no longer red. And you'll not see any rock or stone poking out of the earth. It's all covered with the dead leaves, layers and layers. So that after a while, it becomes soft and nice, and this is excellent for root development. And then nearby there are host trees, one or two, so that this air potato needs a host to climb on. So, we make a little hole in the ground, plant it and close it off. So, that is one more example of the jungly, lazy man farming type of cultivation. Also take a look at the Haldinia cordifolia over there, show that leaf. This is a variety of very fast growing dryland tree called Haldinia cordifolia. It's also called Haldu. And this year's patchy rain and sunlight has caused this some slight disease attack on the leaves. Now this tree is about 30 feet tall now. It's 5 years old. He planted a stump, a 5-foot stump I got from Auroville and planted. And it has grown remarkably fast. And it's one of the good fast growing trees and grows very, very tall also. Now in these organic gardens, the selection of seeds is quite an important subject. Since normally the organic gardeners are into conservation and such things, it's a good idea to try to get some heirloom seeds and give these vanishing vegetable varieties a nice home in your garden, and also you can eat them later, seeds can be multiplied. And so in my quest to collect some nice seeds, this is one of my proud possession. It's called Star of David. These fruits are quite fat and juicy, and if you pluck them tender, these ribs are very succulent. It's nice to cook and have as a fresh vegetable, and much appreciated in our house. And also it's quite hardy, and being an ancient heritage variety, it's resistant to many of the diseases and quite easy to cultivate. I found that they need plenty of feed, and in between watering it's a good idea to let the soil dry once. But without enormous amount of compost and vermicompost feeding, the fruits will be small. They'll get smaller as they go along. So use plenty of old vermicompost to feed, and then space it nicely, at least 1.5 feet gap. And after every harvest, after every fruit, some fresh feeding is needed, otherwise it will stop growing further. And they pollinate very fast. So if you want to preserve the variety, don't grow any other type of this ladyfinger in the nearby, because the bees will take the pollen from this variety and take it there, and then it gets genetically mixed up. So if you want to take up any heirloom seeds, try to stick to one variety and specialize in that. And once you're done with the crop, you can take up the next one. Star of David has now got attacked by some insect, these insects, and since we are all very much against pesticides, we are just catch them physically and drown them in some water, and then we trim off those fruits that are attacked, and then we wait for the next crop to come. By the time they will die out, that's the hope. Today, from now on, we'll be focusing on the various insects and all that we find in this organic gardens. And I want to do this because many people have told me that I'm not documenting things systematically in this garden. And for that reason, I thought we'll document everything with photos. And there are no experts, unfortunately, to tell the names of many of these insects. So if any of you who are watching the videos can tell the name, we'll be grateful. And third point is the high level of biodiversity that is supported by an organic garden. Now regular monoculture and conventional gardens support very minimum forms of life. There'll be two or three types of vegetable, that too highly bred hybrid types who are very fragile and they need constant care. And then day and night insect, whatever repellents are sprayed, so all types of life slowly goes away and it becomes a ecological desert, even if it looks green. And when insects attack, if there is monoculture, they can spread with lightning speed and infect the whole garden, making the need to use the pesticides inevitable. So having a high biodiversity of species
attracts a lot of insects, and so it is more ecological and it's better for the world if more species are there. Some of them may be very useful species which might have some healing properties and all. So this, now what we are showing is this caterpillars are attacking the radish leaf, this black one, these, and also the cabbage, and the other one, the red one, red insect, caterpillar, that one I have not yet found out what exactly is the host plant, but we can see them scurrying around on the ground in the morning. And they're quite active and colorful, and you can't make out which is the front, whether it's this or this.
Today we'll take a look at the ridge gourd. Now I want to say a few words about the gourd family. These gourds are a very ancient family of vegetables which humans have been consuming for thousands of years. And for all the gourds, there's a wild counterpart and a vegetable counterpart which has been domesticated and bred to increase the sweetness and reduce the bitterness. And in our Indian system of medicine and cuisine, these gourds are having the top position as far as vegetables are concerned. Since they are juicy and they grow in the air, they are considered to be good for the brain, and they are rehydrating in the hot weather, And if people have lost moisture or they are in a dryish condition, these vegetables are wonderful for rehydrating with minerals and vitamins and all that. And most of them, the skin is also edible if you know how to cook it. And they are all water lovers. All the goats need everyday watering. Otherwise, they'll get depressed and they'll drop all the little fruits. And if you don't water for 3-4 days, they'll die. So, daily watering in the non-rainy season. And sunny disposition. They like plenty of sun. And you can also intercultivate some bean or any other gourd also with them together, side by side. They tolerate that combined growing. Now, I want to say a few words on the growing conditions, what are required for good crop, disease free and all that. One is, never do large areas of a single vegetable, because that makes it convenient for the predators, pests to multiply and settle down into colonies and breed and eat everything in a relaxed way. And you will be forced to use pesticides and all. So, scatter the plants little bit, and you can have 3-4 plants in one bunch, that's all right. And for the base of the plant, it needs a thin layer of constant mulching in the summer, because in our Indian conditions the evaporation is very high. So what we do is we cover this banana mulch, and so that every time watering is done, the moisture is retained till the next watering. Some insect is there. Can I bring it to the sun? You can show that. What? It's earthworm, is it? Some centipede kind of. Centipede. So, I recommend plenty of vermicompost right at the beginning, and then at every stage go on adding small quantities of vermicompost, thin on the surface, and then collect all the good quality at mulch, preferably like Syzygium, Ficus, Teak. Teak leaves give very good result. Lagostemia, Pongamia, all the dry leaves that are falling in the beginning of the end of the winter, you can collect and spread quite thin, not thick, because then termites will come. We don't want much termite attack. A little termites is all right. They open up the soil because they make tunnels and the water can penetrate nicely into the ground. And these termite tunnels also make it easy for the tender roots to penetrate the earth very fast. They'll get into one of those termite tunnels and go along the termite tunnel, spreading the sideways lateral roots and all. So the rooting will be extensive, and that will help the plant to be long-lived and yield well. And these gourds, as long as you go on feeding them and watering them every day, make sure the water never dries up, the soil, they can last up to a year. They'll have 3 to 4 rounds of flowering, and almost like a perennial, they can behave if the conditions are right. After 1 or 2 fruiting, if you stop watering and feeding, it will die off immediately. So you can maintain one of these gourds for a whole year, if you are a little lucky and careful. And collect and hold your mulch. Keep the soil rich in carbon so that it can hold the moisture. Even a small rain or a little shower moist the whole place. And then they decompose slowly into the earth by earthworms and ants and all, then little colonies of insects are established. They'll all eat and they'll do their number 2, and that's all good manure for these plants. So the base is very important. Don't make it clean like a sterilized place, because that's anti-nature. Nature doesn't like that sterilized look. That's good for some operation theaters. Here you have put plenty of mulch, allow all the creatures to also survive side by side with us. And then you can see there is no disease attack. Vegetable is looking so delicious and healthy. We are going to cut it very soon. If you want to save it for seeds, in the summer the flies will come, fruit flies, and they'll punch holes and lay eggs and all. If you like a particular fruit, usually the 3rd or 4th fruit, you can cover it in some cloth or some
cardboard, this brown paper or something, so that insects don't attack. Now already some ant can be seen here, no? See, ants are surveying, but nothing is attacked, it's healthy. And then sometimes in the middle, these are the babies. This is the first stage, after the flower, see, this is the bud and the flower. These ants and all also pollinated. There's one more variety of ant there. And then after pollination, it comes, takes this size, the first size. At this point, if the food is not enough or water is not enough, it will fall. It will become like this. It will shrivel up and then slowly go brown. That's the end of one fruit. So in between, our borewell had given trouble, so we couldn't water for 2 days, this happened. So every day watering. And if you find these little fruits are just drying and dropping, that means you have not watered enough and fed it enough. And this string bean, which is an excellent, best among beans for the summer vegetable, it doesn't cause gas. If people are having liver trouble and all kind of allergies and all, this is the least allergic among the beans. So this string bean can grow very nicely along with the ridge gourd. And here one more thing I want to show. Often people are spending money buying the granite pillars to make these stand for the plant to grow. Now this granite mining is ruining so many hills. They are putting dynamite and blasting it day and night. Such laborers are all in horrible conditions. Some of them are dying in the... When they blast that dynamite, that spray of that granite powder is coming. It hits the face or somewhere, they die. And then their children and all will be playing in the surrounding area. So, don't encourage these granite pillars and all. You can collect an old pipe, leaking pipe or disused pipe from the farm, and then you can stand it up. They serve very well as pillars. It's lightweight, you don't need people to carry it, and it lasts forever. At the top, you can use some bamboo, like this. So, that's some little show on our ridge gourd. I've written all about its medicinal properties in the bottom part in the write-up, so you can all read it and use it. Today we look at some more photos and one more video on this bitter gourd. Now, since the last almost 2 years, I have been working on these bitter gourds. And we got all kind of varieties, and I found now that 3-4 distinct types are emerging. One is that dwarf tiny variety, another one is long and very bitter and light green, and one more is somewhat medium bitter and dark green, looks very nice. And then this is the fourth variety that has come. Here the ridges and all are not very sharp and pronounced like the other three varieties. It's more rounded, and I don't know how the seed has come. Either it is genetically it is now surfacing, or it is some seed has come in. Anyway, that's a shot of that bitter gourd. Now I'm growing this in a pot. Now that this bitter gourd I have grown in my perma pot. There is already one video made on this perma pot. We grow garlic and onion last year. It's there in this video series. Now, this is the perma pot. It's basically an old plastic drum that's been cut off. And then, that bitter gourd started its life here. See there. And then it has climbed on to the lemon tree there. And I have added fresh vermicompost and manure, because otherwise the fruits will be very tiny, number will be less. And then I cover it with a layer of lagerstamia, dry leaves, so that it is, the whole day it has to be moist, because in the pot the loss of moisture is high. Roots also can't spread much. So it becomes over dependent on human interference. I'm watering twice a day and cover this these dry leaves, and then over that this colocasia leaf is closed so that it retains the moisture nicely throughout the hot day.
like this if I'm taking close.
And then otherwise it has all the features of the regular bitter gourd, except the shape is little different. And as usual, they are very clever in hiding these bitter gourds. So whatever we do, one or two will escape notice and ripen up. And since I've been growing now for last 2 years, quite a few unharvested fruits were there. And it ripened on the plant and then the birds have dispersed it. Nowadays I find that it has become naturalized in the garden. And it's become like a weed. It started growing on its own here and there. You find them sprouting new plants. And probably these will have the highest vigor and surviving energy because they're on their own almost, adjusting to the seasons. And here at the base of this lemon plant, there is one little bitter gourd baby has just sprouted. It has come on its own. The birds have dropped the seed and it's sprouted. So I'll allow it. I'll water it and climb it onto this citrus plant. So both can get the water. I'll get a crop of citrus and some bitter gourd. That's the permapot bitter gourd story. Today we'll look at some of the radish plants, and this year unfortunately the radish didn't form properly, the root, but the flowering and seeding is in good form. And these seed pods and the green are very nice vegetable. They can be stir fried and it has a crunchy and like aroma like a radish. And two varieties of flowers have come, and the bees appear to like the flowers. 2-3 varieties of bees are visiting. So we'll save some seeds and then the rest of it will be eaten as a vegetable. The leaves are also one by one we cut and we cook. It's a good vegetable, the leaf, seasonal vegetable. And in the winter, this radish is the ideal vegetable because it has that spiciness, and it clears the lung congestion and then that sinus type of blockages, as well as it activates the digestive system if it is sluggish. And all in all, it's a good thing to have in the winter, and therefore nature provides it in plenty in this season. In the summer, they are all shriveling up and you have to use all kind of support system to keep them alive. But in this season, quite naturally, they are doing well. These and the carrots, all the root items do well in our Indian winter. Before they get into biting mode, we have to wind down. But I think these are not much into biting. Thank you. These are the Swarnadhara chicks. They are 40 days old, 40 to 45 days old. And they are eating morning snack of weeds. They eat about 3 to 4 kgs of weeds every day. We have 100 chicks in this batch. For this batch, we have fed only the starter feed for the first 1 month. And then, second month, we started tapering down the starter feed and giving the second quality of feed, second stage feed, and introduced the weeds and azolla, and then some grains, that is jowar, some millet, and paddy. This also we started feeding them, and the regular feed what we give the grown up hens also little by little we start introducing in the second month, so that from the third month they can eat the same food as the grown up hens. That is no more of this ready made stuff, but our own mixture of the whole grains.
Ba 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 ba.
ಆಮೇಲೆ
ಇದೊಂದು ಇದೊಂದು ಅದು ಒಂದು ಕೆ ಜಿ ಕೊಡಿ.
ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಸಕ್ಕರೆ
ಕೊಡು. ಈ ಬೇಳೆ
ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಸಕ್ಕರೆ ಕೊಡು.
ಇದು ಮೊಳಕೆ ಬರುತ್ತಾ ನಟ್ರೆ?
ಅದು ಮೊಳಕೆ ಬರಲ್ಲ.
ಬೇಯಿಸಿರೋದು
ಬೇಯಿಸಿರೋದಲ್ಲ, ಅದು ಮೊಳಕೆ ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ಬಟ್ ಅದು ಲೇಟ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಅದು
Centella asiatica, that is the Manduka Parni in Sanskrit and also called Vandelaga in Kannada, and it's also known as it has a bunch of names, and it's a popular culinary as well as a powerful herb for the brain. I've already shown a couple of videos on this herb, but this Western Ghat region is the original home of this species, and we get best result with minimum work over here.
it occurs as a weed. And what we have done here, I found a patch where it's naturally occurring and removed all the competitors, so that slowly it is now dominating. And we fed the at the base the chicken compost, which is giving excellent results. The leaves are really nice and superb. And this is how some of the best centella is grown in the world. Also, I'd like to show you a Chippiparai hound. So the camera will now turn in that direction. The dogs don't behave. So it's difficult to catch them.
Side view.
Kar ya. Hey, kar. Ready.
Ek maar bada, moonu maar bada. Hange kutkon torsu jaan bada mohoitu.
Kar ya. Hey, kar.
Yeah, let's have a close-up of this
leaf and then come look at the soil. It's quite fertile and a little sticky soil is good for them. They like waterlogged condition, the Centella asiatica. And normally they occur naturally in valley bottoms, in wet areas, and then in paddy fields and there's no cultivation.
Herb that is this Camphaeria galangal, also called rasna. It's an ingredient in the organic chyawanprash, and I have intercultivated with the Centella asiatica here. And again, this is the I am now in the Western Ghats and very moist region with about 200 centimeters of rain per year. 200, huh? 150 centimeters a year, about average. And this year we hardly got 10% of the 10-15% of the rain. Now also I will show some tulsi, how to raise the tulsi seedlings. Now take a sack like this, fill it up with compost. Ekari. And then sprinkle the tulsi seeds. They're very tiny seeds, and it needs to be exposed to direct sunlight, otherwise the sprouting won't happen. Seeds need to feel the sunlight on the surface. So put it in an exposed area with a soil that is quite loose and nice, like this, and then sprinkle the seeds on top, and then put it out in the sun. You'll get thousands and thousands of seedlings, and then start picking out the biggest ones first, like this. Now at this size, that is 1, 2, 3 sets of leaves, it can be planted anywhere and it will grow. Like this is how I plant in my primitive. So that's planted. Now one more rainfall and she'll start growing. So that's how this Krishna tulsi and then all the various tulsis, that is Osimum sanctum, is grown. This herb is very good for preventing chikungunya and dengue, all kind of fevers. If one has a few couple of leaves in the tea or something once every few days, you will never get that chikungunya or all those fevers. Particularly in that rainy season and when these kind of diseases start coming up, grow a couple of these tulsi and then you can pluck a couple of leaves like this and add it into your tea. Also, it's a good luck. It's considered as a symbol of goddess Lakshmi, and having this plant in the garden ensures prosperity for the family. That's another video for today.
Today I am going to introduce two of our calves. Both of them are male, and one in the front is a mixed breed of Hallikar mother, and that father is Gir. It's Hallikar and Gir mixed, and so it's quite a big, going to become a big animal, but with a much slimmer version than the Gir, having a, which is better for our region here, you know, little slim body. And he is one of the new bull of this range what we have taken up, and he is about how old is he? Age? Age is
7 months.
Huh?
7 months.
7 months old. ಹತ್ರ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕಿರ ಎದ್ದು ಮೆಲ್ಲ ಒಂದು ಮೂರು ಹೆಜ್ಜೆ ಹತ್ರ ಹೋಗು, ಅದು ಗಾಬರಿ ಆಗುವ ಅಷ್ಟು ಹತ್ರ ಹೋಗಿ ಹೊಡೆದ್ ಕ್ಲೋಸ್ ಮಾಡು. ನಾ ಕಡೆ ಈಗ ತೆಗಿ. In this video, I want to introduce a very important concept of the forest farms, traditional forest farm at least. That is called a jungly patch. A certain percentage of the area is set aside for the without cultivation. We just abandon it and allow nature to kind of take over that place. And as you can see, this part what I have saved in the forest for the forest farm for the jungly patch is now overgrown, full of bushes, thorns, creepers, all kind of things have come up, seasonal weeds and all go in and grow. And this acts as an important harbor and a safe haven for all kind of new plants, creatures, insects to come and safely settle down here. We are going to harvest the vidari roots today, one of them. This plant was planted about 2.5, almost 3 years back, and it should have been harvested last year itself. We have left it in the ground. So some portion has been eaten up by some insect. Since it's very nutritious, it attracts lot of insect attack after a while. ಒಂದೇ ಶಾರ್ಟ್ ಹಿಡ್ಕೋ, ತೋರಿಸ್ಕೊಷ್ಟೆ, ಫಾಸ್ಟ್ ಮೂವ್ ಮಾಡಿ. ನೀನು ನೋಡ್ಕೊ ಈ ಕಡೆ ಅಂತ ಬಾ. As you can see, the roots spread out in all directions, separate roots. And this particular specimen, this plant, I have neither watered it nor manured it. So,
in quite a harsh conditions it's grown.
Big, no?
It's huge.
Disappointing.
I think it's big. What do you mean it's not big? It's huge.
Yagul Boras the size of the Lala. Nella got big. When we break it off, Madi, we can make a second one after this.
We'll continue this one after a few minutes. No, this is actually not a very good crop. A good crop should be at least 20 kgs. This should probably about 8 to 10 kilos. But nevertheless, it's quite a root and we haven't sprayed any. It doesn't get pests or any kind of disease. It's a good forest crop and good food crop, good farm crop also. And one of the easiest things to grow. This is the fruit of the Ficus racemosus, also called Audumbara tree. And I want to explain it, the speciality of this fruit. In the flower stage itself, it has a particular wasp, or some kind of a insect that lays its eggs. And then the fruit develops, there will be a couple of worms inside. And this fruit is eaten by all kind of forest animals and birds, these ficus fruits, and they spread the seed all around. And for the birds, because it contains a worm or two inside, it's like a beautiful sandwich where there's some protein and then there's some carbohydrate and all that in the rest of the fruit. And it makes a perfect balanced meal for these birds and bats and all that. And this is the leaf of that Ficus racemosus. This is how you can make out. It's not that thick, more thin, unlike other Ficus leaves. And that's a stem, the same Ficus racemosus. That's the fruit. Here in this video, we'll look at a cross section of the hedge where I'll explain why this kind of hedges are extremely important in a forest farm situation. Now, we are going close to the hedge. The front row of this portion has the Alpinia galanga. You can show the flower, it's nice. Very pretty flowers, and it's a herb, it's an income fetching herb. And then when you go one step forward, there's calamus here. This is a thorny herb, medicinal herb of Ayurveda, which is still about 4 years old and just now peeping out of the hedge. This one, you can see the thorns. I can see so low portion. Okay? This is a calamus stem, the thorns. These are horrible thorns, by the way. And then, beyond that is the Arthoda. Now, let's sit down here. See, at the ground level inside the hedge, all these leaves have fallen. This is the mulch creation is happening. And then this is a good place. No one disturbs this section. So, ants can have an undisturbed place for their nests. And I raised a little bit that side so that the water doesn't flow out. It traps the water. Provides a permanent home for ants and all kind of insects, and it generates mulch, a lot of mulch, because these shrubs put out their own dry leaves. and blocks the wind, improves the groundwater situation by improving percolation, and improves the biodiversity. See how much space is created. This I call as the first floor. That's the ground floor here, down there. Here is the first floor. And then all over there will be spiders and all kind of little birds can make the nest here. And then we come up, second floor, little higher. And then here the calamus is peeping out. And then we come to the fourth floor, where the top of the, this section we can trim periodically so that the height is maintained like that. And then this is the Erythrina indica. It's a nice hedge tree also. Oh, I'm getting bit in my eye. Okay, now go forward like that. Now this Arthoda vasa is excellent hedge where watering cannot be done. It's quite hardy and it provides little white flowers for the nectar sucking birds in the peak of the summer. One more plant. Now go forward. So this is the end of the hedge. The whole hedge is about 4 feet wide. At the bottom, some grasses also there. These also stop the rainwater from flowing.
You can see a stark difference from the outside and the inside.
This is the one of the wonders of nature. And anyone who owns this tree can consider himself as a wealthy man, or family or whatever. Now I'll explain a little bit about this tree. It's called jackfruit. See the bark? It's quite smooth, dark. There's no big fissures at all. This wood is a yellow color wood, is good for making doors and such things eventually when the tree dies. But only an idiot will cut this tree, because the fruits are so versatile and amazing. See, this is the biggest fellow here. He's ready to cut now. And then this is the second stage. See, the little, these thorny things are less prominent. And this is the third stage, even younger. I think probably these are something to do with the flower. And now we'll have a look at something even younger. See, before that it looks like this. It's only 1 inch long. This is a bud, it's not yet opened. Okay, and then see this. Here the bud is just opening and the first stage of the fruit is getting exposed. See, amazing thing. And then as it grows, it comes to this size and finally it becomes like this. And the biggest of them can be up to 15 kilos and a whole bunch of people can eat them up. This is a leaf. The seed is a very nice, can be ground up and eaten. Very nice, ground up and cooked and eaten. Very nutritious thing. And storable. The seeds can be dried and kept for a while also. And the fruit is very tasty. The, all animals of the forest like this fruit. Right from elephants to cows to horses.
Monkeys.
Monkeys, of course. And of course, the ultimate monkey, we all like it ourselves. So this is one of the nice tree, nature's gift. This is the base of the same shrub what we saw just now. How I am handling the situation at the base. Now Portulaca is there growing here. That's a vegetable. And then there's a small, there is a vidari. That is the giant potato. Now all the extra water what I am pouring for the bitter gourd, she is also going to get a bit of it, and by the time they are all finished, this one will start climbing up. And then the mulch of Syzygium, because it's summer here and every day bitter gourd needs watering to trap the moisture and to keep the temperature cool, because this creates micro spaces in between. Where air gets trapped, it becomes a nice micro-environment. And also the bottom layer starts decomposing. See, worms are there, earthworms are coming, no? So, not much of mulch, but steady application of mulch. Then you get a nice colored healthy vegetables on top, and it's quite disease free. At the bottom you can put some potato, sweet potato, any other root item like this vidari fits in well. And then a couple of these ground loving kind of a small edible herbs like mint can be planted here, and a little couple of beans can fit in very well. So with one watering source, one shrub, let's see the species now. This vitex, and then bitter gourd, and then the basal alba, and the string bean, and the vidari, that's a giant potato, and the portulaca, a couple of beans, amaranthus. See this amaranthus. So about 10 or 15 type of food items, and a couple of medicinal herbs also. That amrutabandi, the tinospora alba is climbing there.
There's bala on the other end.
So about 15 species you can cover up by cleverly placing it up, one on the other, with each of them can coexist. And the ants have made the nest, show that nest, see. So these ants never ever do the idiotic thing of destroying them, because they'll not make sure no insect comes and lands on this plant. Look at those soldiers. If I spray something on this plant now, they'll also die. Which is the dumbest thing anyone can do. This is one section of the hedge in our forest palm. And this hedge doesn't fetch, it doesn't get much water. So I have filled up mostly with the Arthoda Vasa, which does quite well with minimum water. You can see its lush growth has happened. And then we are going to cover a very important part of the forest farm, that is water harvesting. Basically what we do is, at the lowest part of the farm, where all the water finally drains out, when there's extra heavy rain, once in 2 or 3 years it rains all night long. On those days, the water fills up the whole farm and then it starts flowing out. And we don't want to waste any of the groundwater. We want to trap all the rainwater. We don't want to waste the rainwater. So make a huge pit at the lowest point, like this one. And then it's about 20 feet wide by 20 feet wide and about 20 feet deep. Quite a big pit. And the water all drains into this, and then from there it goes into the ground and recharges our bore well. So when you start with a project like this, find the lowest lying point, hire a JCB, dig a huge pit there, so that not a drop of rain that falls on your land is allowed to flow away. It should all sink in right there. That's one way of keeping the moisture and saving the water, and also the nutrients that wash off with the soil erosion. So down view like that, yeah. See how it is. Today I'm going to introduce people who are not familiar with the new. It's not really new, it's a very ancient millet called ragi. Now, this is the ragi grains. This ragi is it's a superfood, and it is kind of little ugly. It's dark and not that kind of flashy and attractive like rice and all. So, it is unglamorous. Poor thing, but actually it can be promoted all over the world as a solution to many of the health problems and health crises that people are facing. Now I'll focus in this video mainly on the ragi as from a consumer's point of view. So now little background about ragi. It's originated in Africa, from Tanzania, Ethiopia and these kind of places. And the people have been eating this for 5,000, maybe even 20,000 years. It's one of the most ancient grains that humans cultivated. And from a cuisine, from a health point of view, health food point of view, it has, this ragi has some absolutely unique qualities that no other grain is having. First and foremost, it has a very hard to digest outer shell, and therefore it is impervious to insect attack if it is properly stored. These ragi grains retain their life up to 50 years. So if countries want to hold some kind of a food supply for emergencies and droughts and all, this is the grain that can be stored, because it is naturally resistant to insect attack and all those little bugs and all which ruin the food grains. Rice and wheat and all are very susceptible. So if one acquires a drumful of this ragi and properly stores it in an airtight container, you can even rely, open it after 25 years and it will be nice to eat. So countries should consider promoting this as a key crop for survival in times of extreme crisis, and they are saying global warming and droughts and rainfall variation, all kind of dire predictions are coming out. So in such a situation, countries can rather store ragi as in their godowns for the emergency whatever food security, rather than the other grains, simply because if it is not used in this year, or suppose let's assume that you have stocked up this ragi and then no emergency happens, there's bountiful harvest, people don't want it, there's no need for it. Then if you had stored, let's say, rice or wheat or anything else, in 2 years it has to be animal feed, because the humans can't consume it anymore. You have to replenish the stock year after year. But in the case of ragi, even after 3 years, 5 years, it can, once you stocked it up, it's like gold actually. It can last for so many years. And that's one part about the storage benefits of what natural properties of this one as far as storage is concerned. Then the second issue is the ease of growing. This fantastic crop, it doesn't need any pesticide whatsoever. So when you buy ragi, you don't have to ask for any certification, because it nobody pesticides this ragi. And also it doesn't require much additional fertilization, a little urea normally they add. And so it is from contamination point of view, it is one of the safest. It is not grown in wetlands using polluted water like some of the paddy, rice and all that. This is grown in the highlands and it's a rain-fed crop, so it is not grown using polluted water, it doesn't require pesticides, it requires very minimum fertilization, and it is extremely versatile. It's a 3-month crop, and it's in between the season, if there is people run out of food, this is the best one to quickly replenish the stock, because within 3 months you have something that's long lasting. And now as far as the consumer is concerned, this ragi, all the grains now, most of the grains that we eat, they have a acid, they create acidic situation in the stomach at the end of the digestion, even in the blood. So most of the modern people are suffering from acidic blood. They're eating a lot of sugar. From day one, the children are fed, addicted to sugar, then that is acidifying. Then a lot of people are consuming alcohol, that is acidifying. And then all this junk food, ready-made food, packed food, everything acidifies your body. Once your blood gets acidified, then the alkaline acid balance gets disturbed in your body, arthritis, osteoporosis and mouth sores, all kind of complications can start. And liver trouble, for liver people with liver trouble, this is one of the best grain. All because it can never give you acid reflux. Some acid is trying to rush out in the opposite direction into the mouth sometimes after eating, we eat too much. That comes from over acid production. And then burning in the stools and all that. Also because the whole system gets inflamed. That piles, gills and all kind of unmentionable complications. All the digestive ailments can be tackled by consuming this ragi. And apart from that, it is recommended for babies and people who are convalescing and to give strength. Because unlike other grains, this one has one of the protein is there in it. It's not just carbohydrate, it has a protein component. It has a lot of iron and minerals and calcium. And all in all, it's a wonder food, and I recommend people who are not exposed to this ragi to study about it little bit. And who have never tried it, try to procure some ragi and get the benefit of it. Apart from that, the real beauty of this crop is it's the cheapest grain. Now, rice must be about 30-40 rupees a kg. And this wheat and all of them are costing at least double of this ragi. So from an ecological point of view, it's a good crop. From a national security and a individual food security, if you're worried about your food supplies, I would recommend you to store this ragi rather than any other grain. So for ecological purposes, it's extremely superior. It doesn't need pesticides, fertilizer, all that. And then from a consumer's point of view, it is least polluted. It rarely contains toxic residues because it's not grown in those places. It doesn't need much water and it doesn't need pesticides. So it has no residue, very little residues, economical, high shelf life, and it has protein, it has minerals, it has calcium, and it's alkaline. Unlike all those other grains, this is the only one that's alkaline and strengthens the bones and all. So, and easy to grow. So I recommend this as a crop for all people who are concerned about food security and who are into gardening, not exactly gardening, but farming and food-based industries. They should have a look at this ragi and don't be misled by its little rustic and unglamorous look. Beauty is only skin deep. Deep inside properties make it the number one grain as far as humanity is concerned today, in my humble opinion.